Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the celebration of Nanci Griffith's Grammy-nominated album, Flyer. So put your seatback up and your carry-on away. We wish you a safe and a pleasant flight, and thank you for flying the Michigan Theatre. Now, please make welcome electro recording artist Nanci Griffith and the Blue Moon Orchestra.
You're out of school. This next song was written for me by a dear friend by the name of Julie Gold back in 1986 from my Lone Star State of Mind album. And it's always been a blessing to sing, and I've had the opportunity to sing it and record it in four different languages. And since in 1986, it's been recorded by about 40 different artists and all over the world. And no matter how many times it becomes a hit in any given place, it's always a blessing to sing. So in Julie's own words, de lejos, de loin, a usted afiané, from a distance.
Thank you.
songwriters for the past 35 or 40 years. He's a gentleman who really gave birth to the Bakersfield sound with the songs he wrote, like Heartaches by the Number and Pick Me Up on Your Way Down and Tiger by the Tail. And went on from there to write a lot of Patsy Cline's hits, My Fall to Pieces, and then kind of crossed over into pop music and wrote pop songs and had hits with those. He wrote Busted for Ray Charles, and then all the way up to present times when he wrote most of the Jugs hits, and at the age of 68 still has the biggest heart of any songwriter I've ever known. It remains open. And this is his hometown, Ann Arbor, Michigan. You should have a statue of him in the square. To Harlan Howard, orphan of the times, Ann Arbor, Michigan. He's a brilliant man, and he was an orphan here in Ann Arbor and grew up in foster homes. And when he was a tender age of 12, his wife sent off wrote to the county up here, got all of his records, which are more detailed than any parent's records of a child, because caseworkers keep elaborate journals, you know. And there was a wonderful story about Harlan. When he was 12, he was sent to live on a farm about 20 miles outside of Ann Arbor, and with a couple whose kids were already grown, and they just wanted to raise another child. And they were very nice and everything, but they were a little bit older, and they went to bed really early at night, you know, like 8 o'clock. They were ready to go to bed, and he had chores to do, and he had to get up early in the mornings, so he ran away and came back into town because he also had a crush on his caseworker. And at the age of 12, he thought that this 22-year-old caseworker had a crush on him as well. And so he ran away, and he came back into town. And in the interview, in the records, it states that the caseworker asked Harlan, "Why did you run away? Were they mean to you? Did they hit you? Did they do anything to you to abuse you or anything at all? It was such a nice family." He said, "Oh no, they were great people. They were really great people. You know, we just didn't have anything in common. And he said, besides that, I just can't see myself shoveling manure for the rest of my life." So at 12 years old, you know, it was brilliant. He was a brilliant kid. So to Ann Arbor for giving birth to a wonderful orphan by the name of Harlan Howard. He co-wrote this next song with me for my new album, Flyer, and it's a real honor to have co-written a song with Harlan Howard because he normally writes by himself. Over here, this wonderful woman is the most talented woman that I know on this earth. She plays anything with strings on it, and she's playing the classical lead guitar on this song that Harlan and I wrote, which neither Harlan nor myself can play. Miss Lee Satterfield, kick it off. Say it isn't so for Harlan. Tell me to tell the lie.
Dusty boats and faded Thank you.
records have really saved my life on a number of occasions, just from their music, just listening to them gives me some sort of comfort in life. And when I did my Late Night Grand Hotel album, I recorded four of this gentleman's songs, and this is the one that ended up on the record. When we made that album, it was such a delight for me and a dream come true, because I got to work with the London Philharmonic, so it was really wonderful to have to sing in an orchestra and feel all that wood in one room, you know, on the soundstage. It was just such a marvelous feeling. And then, of course, when the record came out, the critics just slayed me. They said, oh, this album is overproduced. Now, of course it's overproduced. There's a symphony on there. I mean, you know, there's like 60 people on strings on there. Of course it's overproduced. You missed the point. Totally. At any rate, it was one of the favorite albums that I'd ever made. And so it was a real disappointment when that's all they could talk about was how overproduced the record was. And there it was, a dream come true for me. And to record this gentleman's songs was a real delight for me, because his music had done so much for me. So to Bruce Springsteen and to the gentleman who wrote this next song, Tom Waits, the San Diego Symphony.
I never saw the moonlight till it shone all over.
one of my dearest friends, and a gentleman who's really special to me, and probably America's greatest humorist of folk songwriters. And he's always had this one thing, his 15 years that I've known him, that he hadn't accomplished yet in life, and that was that he always wanted to have just one fat little baby all his own, that he could take out the yard and play with and teach things to, actually just somebody who would listen to him. And, you know, it just never happened, you know. He was like going through life, and that thing just never happened. He just couldn't find a woman who would put up with him long enough to do that sort of thing. And finally, at the tender age of 49, he did, and got together with a friend of mine. And just 3 months ago, to a wonderful, fat little baby boy named Jack, who was born with a full head of hair and a little mustache, just like this. So may John Prine never know the speed of the sound of loneliness again.
Thank you. But these Delta towns, they were settling down in a hiding fight. The word of the end got my hands to the radio. Where would I be in times like these without songs or hit a road? Hey, my friends, look out the radio. Oh, when you hey, my friends, look out the radio. Oh, radio.
Music. I don't know why no one would pay any attention. But I've been proud to have him in our band for the past 4 years, and it's just wonderful. He's from Cuba via Illinois. Mr. Ron De La Vega back there on the bass and the cello and the harmony. With the Blue Moon Orchestra for the past 7 years, from Dublin, Ireland, Mr. Commitment himself, Mr. Fran Green on the drums. On percussion, your flight captain for the evening, and a gentleman who will show you the lights in the aisles and show you when the oxygen's going to come down and where the exits are, should that become necessary at any given moment in time. And he also played bass on Trouble in the Fields. He's learning how to play bass, and he's doing a great job. He married a bass player who is a brilliant player, and so I think he feels like he needs to learn how to play her bass well, so. Anyway, he's a founding member of the Blue Moon Orchestra with us for the past 9 years, and we're always proud to be on the same stage with him because he comes from the center of the universe, Little Hill, Hempstead, England. Mr. Pat McInerney on percussion. Of course, our founding leader, O fearless one, he who must be obeyed. Gentleman who was all the B3 organ for Al Green and went on to form a band with a bunch of kooks of session players that haven't been top since. I don't know what they played, country punk, country folk, rock, punk, whatever it was, it hasn't been done since. The Amazing Rhythm Aces, he was the Amazing Rhythm Aces with Russell Smith. And then later on, you know, went on to co-write and tour with a lot of people, and he left Steve Winwood back in the High Life to form the Low Life of my Blue Moon Orchestra. He really needs no introduction, but demands to have one. Mr. James Hooker on the keyboards! Lady who plays anything with strings on it, and if she doesn't know how to play it, she just goes and asks her husband, who is an orchestra symphony arranger, and asks him to show her just a little bit now, not all of it, just a little bit, and she'll take it from there. And she's just also a great vocalist and harmony singer and a great songwriter. So the Blue Moon Orchestra and I would like to turn the stage over to her for a song now. Miss Lee Satterfield.
Walking in your shoes all night, still find myself asking why you.
got together in a circle and played music with us, from the Chieftains to Mark Knopfler to the Bodines to Sonny Curtis to everybody that's on there. The list is endless, and we so appreciate all of them, and it was wonderful to work with old friends. And this next song especially goes out to two women who worked on two of my albums now, and they used to tour and open up for me before they got their record deal, and they got their record deal while they were opening for me in Atlanta. And it was really great to see them get a deal because they were so unique, and before they came along, nothing had ever really sounded like the two of them together. And now that they've been so successful, there's a whole lot of things out there that sound a lot like them. And so we send them this song because they added so much with their vocals and their uniqueness to Amy and Emily for shut it down and pull this road down and put this silence in my heart in a better place. I have traveled with your ghost now for so many years, and I see you in the shadows. Through my life, I felt really fortunate that dream of a child has come true, and a lot of great voices have recorded my songs. And there's only been one song that I've always felt a little bit selfish about. And my favorite version of the song isn't another voice, but the voice of the two people who wrote it. And even though our vocals are not the most perfect and they're rough and tumble, James Hooker and Nanci Griffith version of this next song will always be my favorite version. And mind you, when I get in an elevator and I hear this song come on the music, I'm glad I'm going up, and I love hearing the song sung. And but this will always be my favorite version, the version that's never been recorded, of the Gulf Coast Highway. Gulf Coast Highway, you work the rails, you work the rice fields with their cool dirt wells, you work the oil rigs in the Gulf of Mexico. The only thing we've ever known is this old house here by the water. And when he dies, he says he'll catch some black birds away. He will fly away to heaven, some sweet blue by the spring. wrote his next song and sang a duet with him on the album. The gentleman who is the writer and the lead singer for one of my favorite bands, a band called Counting Crows. Mr. Adam Ritz. And we both have a great affection for a little town called Athens, Georgia, which is a wonderful music town, somewhat like my hometown of Austin, Texas. And Athens has given birth to REM and B-52s and Widespread Panic, and it's just a great place to go and get away and go listen to music. It's just all over town. And so we co-wrote the song about going back to Georgia, and James Hooker's going to sing Adam's part. You ready to get on the train? We're off the plane now. Ready to get on the train. Roll on back to Georgia. Here we go.
Oh, the sea snow makes your brown eyes shine. We gotta look real hard to find a reason to cry. New York, New York is a friend of a feeling kind. And now I'm coming around for years of hard times. He's chased me down to the towns and the mines once. Still by love, he was bound to roll on.
it for a whole year, because I, you know, you have this one year when you think about it the whole time. And it finally happened, and that was turning 40 this last summer. It was really frightening. I mean, this is the year that everybody tells you you're going to have to start wearing your trousers backwards, because the bump that you had in the back has moved around to the front now, and they just fit better that way. That didn't happen. I come from a long line of West Texas dirt farmers from the flat plains, you know, so we also have flat butts. I think you just kind of built like the terrain that you come from. So that was a sigh of relief, and my dad threw a huge hoopla party for me for my 40th birthday, and it was, I just couldn't have fun. And he came up to me and he said, "Why won't you have fun? You've never had fun. Not in your entire life have you ever had fun. Nope, even when you were a child. If there was fun being had, you'd go off in a corner and think about it. By the time you were still thinking about it, the fun was over, been there, done that." So I went off and thought about it, you know, and it took me like 5 or 6 months until we got to New Year's Eve that I realized that my dad was right. I never had really had fun. And, you know, so my New Year's resolution was that if it's not fun, don't do it. And when I wrote this next song, it was fun, you know, and for the new album. And I had written it, and, you know, in all the things I could think about, this was the one thing that I really had fun. I really had fun when I wrote this song. It lifted me straight up off the couch, and it was fun. I wanted to call my dad and say, "See there? I can't have fun. Been there, done that." So I send this out, even though the song and the lyrics have nothing to do with my dad. I send it out to him nightly as a blessing, because he taught me a lesson, because he's had fun all his life. And, you know, at 70, I think he should be having fun, but he's always had fun. And this song represents the year of turning 40, and I do know how to have fun, because it's anything you need. For anybody on that cusp of 39. Learn to fly. Even if you
wasn't in it on any of my albums. It's a song that's on a new compilation album called Red Hot Country. That was produced by my friend Kathy Matea, and she gave up a year of her life to produce this album for the Red Hot Foundation, which is a foundation that collects money to do AIDS research and build AIDS hospices around the country. And they're working on all kinds of albums. They've got a Red Hot Jazz album out. And the Red Hot Country album isn't really a country album. It's got all kinds of artists on it. There's like 37 different artists, from Jackson Brown to Crosby, Stills, and Nash, to Willie Nelson, to Dolly Parton, to Jimmy Dale Gilmore, to Levon Helm, to, you know, it's just a kind of an eclectic group of people, all brought together by Kathy Matea, to do something that they'd always wanted to do, which is work with one of their heroes, or record a song with them, or record one of their heroes' songs, and something special that they could only do once, to be as special as the Red Hot Foundation itself. And it was such an honor when Kathy called me and asked me to participate, because it gave me, just a reason to get on that phone and call one of my heroes, a songwriter by the name of Jimmy Webb, and ask him to come in and participate with me and record one of his old songs, because it just seemed like the most appropriate song I had ever heard for this record. And so I sent it out to Jimmy Webb this evening, and to Kathy Matea for the huge heart that she has and for the time that she gives to others. If these old walls could speak.
These walls could speak.
what these walls would say. They were not so mean. These walls could I'm This world tour has been very kind to us, and we've been graced with wonderful audiences and very supportive of a new album and people who sang along and got along with this new record, and we've been really thrilled with that all over the world. And one of the special things that happened to us is that when we started out playing in England 8 years ago, we started out playing in punk clubs because they really didn't know what to do with Nanci Griffith. You know, I really wasn't a country artist, and I was too weird to be a folk artist. And so, you know, they just kind of said, well, we'll put her in these punk clubs. And it was great fun touring England that way, and being passed from one end of the room to the other and all that kind of stuff. But on this world tour, we sold out 3 nights at the Albert Hall. And so we were really grateful for that, and I was grateful that I didn't have to get passed around the Albert Hall. So, but this next song we learned just as a special treat for that show, and it just kind of stuck with us because this was my all-time favorite Beatles song from childhood. And we do know now how many holes it takes to fill the Albert Hall, for those of you who know that song, you're insiders. And so to John Lennon and Paul McCartney, the things we said today. Curtis, in the year I was born in 1954, picked up
Stratocaster guitars out there in West Texas and put their acoustic D18 Martins down and just beat the dickens out of these Stratocasters and changed rock and roll music forever and inspired the Beatles to become the Beatles. And his name is Buddy Holly. And so I sent this song out to his memory this evening, but especially to his friend Sonny Curtis, who was in Buddy Holly and the Crickets and co-wrote a lot of the songs that Buddy had hits with. Sonny Curtis has been a pal of mine for many years. When we were recording this album, I called Sonny up because I really wanted him to come in and play that old West Texas Stratocaster. And he said, you know, Nancy, I haven't played a Stratocaster in 15 years, and I've been doing other things. And you know, I think you ought to get somebody who does it every day and come in and do that. And I said, well, nobody will sound like it. You know, he said, well, send me the song. And he was in Romania doing relief work for children. And for those of you who don't know who Sonny is and aren't aware of, you know, the stuff he did with Buddy Holly and the Crickets, well, after Buddy died, he went on to go with the Everly Brothers, and he wrote Walk Right Back, and he wrote I Fought the Law, and the Law Won. And then if you don't know any of that stuff or any of Sonny's other stuff, well, then there's one thing I know you do know. You hear him on television at least once a week. You've left the television on, you're cooking dinner, you're doing whatever, you're not even paying any attention. It's maybe on Nick at Night or something, you know, and you're standing around, and all of a sudden you hear this sweet West Texas voice, and your heart fills up with warmth, and you feel like going into downtown Ann Arbor and throwing your hat up in the air and saying, you're gonna make it after all. Because Sonny Curtis both wrote and sang the Mary Tyler Moore theme. So that's one of those things he's been doing without the Stratocaster. But he got the tape in Romania and called me up, and a couple of days later, and he said, I'm getting on a plane, Buddy would be proud. So he came back and walked into the studio and picked up that Stratocaster, and it was like he never put it down. And when we left to go on tour, I asked him, I said, what am I going to do now, Sonny? You put this old, dirty, little bit out of tune West Texas rhythm Stratocaster on my record, and who's going to play it? Everybody in my band plays a tune. Nobody's from West Texas. And he said, well, you know, Nancy, you're lower than West Texas trailer trash yourself, and it wouldn't hurt you none to play it yourself. So thanks to Sonny and all in giving to the Year of Having Fun, and thanks to Fender Guitars for you know, paying attention to Sonny and sending me all these Stratocasters. I'm having fun, Sonny, and I'm playing your guitar part. I got enough dirt beneath my fingernails, and I'm just enough out of tune to send this heart out to you. Thank you. girl blessing, because it was a song of mine that she saved last year, a song that I had written a couple of years ago, and Sarah recorded it and did a brilliant version of it, and because of her recording it, Peter Buck heard it, and he loved it so much, he said, well, when he was producing part of the album, he said, what about that song? I really like that song. So thanks to Sarah, we just recorded this song again last week, and I'm so honored, because you're such a great songwriter, and to do one of my songs, it's a real treat. I'm such a fan, you know, and thanks for saving time and inconvenience. I really, it's wonderful of you. We're very proud to have Miss Sarah Hickman out on the road. As I said, I'm a fan, and we've been wanting to get her out on the road with us for a long time, so we're proud to have her out on this world tour. You just knock them dead every night. Well, this next song will always be, along with Time of Inconvenience, one of the most important folk songs, oh, that F word again, that I've ever written, you know. And I hope that I live to be 100, and I hope that I'll always remember, you know, that this song was the most important piece of work. And if I do live that long, since it'll be a long time away, I also hope that it'll no longer be relevant on earth, and people will go, what was she talking about? Because Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. taught us that there are no bad babies born on this earth, that all children are born good. It's what we give them in love and teach them in wisdom that they return to us in the future. And Lyndon Johnson taught us that we are a great society. And I've never been much of an orator. My voice was always just a little bit too squeaky, you know. But Nanci Griffith says that racism is one of the most silent forms of abuse you can do to your children by teaching them. And we are a great society, but we can be greater because we owe it to our children, because it's a hard life wherever you go.
Thank you.
goes up as a special tribute this evening to my friends Dave and Linda Siglin. It's an art for me, I tell you. Their daughter Anya was in this evening singing. It's been very strange to watch her grow up, and now Dave and Linda are grandparents. And they remind me a lot of my parents, because my parents were beatniks. And if there has ever been a couple that I knew who were actually in that category, it was Dave and Linda at the yard. Linda and I share that generation with a lot of you. Our mothers were the first ones in history to teach us, as women folk, we can do anything, we can have anything, we can build anything, and we can do it all by ourselves. We're a living, breathing experiment, yet unfinished. So to Linda and Dave's daughter, Anya, congratulations on the new baby. Linda, how's it feel to be a grandmother? And to my mother, God bless you, thank God they only give you one. Flipping bottle caps through the ring around the moon, all alone on Saturday night with stars and moon. I am the vision of my mother's dream come true, built this house out in the air. All by my own will, I got love enough for two, and it's just me and this old moon. And the sailors on the water, they all want the captain's daughter. They want her beauty and her youth to grace them out on the sea. Me, I'm ignored, and I'm plain as plain can be. Got a bank full of mother's dream. Maybe mother just didn't see that love.
They want her.